A very good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. Apologies have been received from Pauline McNeill this morning, and Colette Stevenson, Fulton McGregor and Rona Mackay are joining us remotely. One of our witnesses for panel one is slightly delayed. So our first item of business today is our first evidence session on the Fireworks and Pyrotechnic Articles Scotland Bill. Before we begin, I'd like to place on record our thanks to the Blackburn Bonfire Night Action Group for hosting our visit on Monday. It was extremely helpful to hear how the local community have worked to tackle the misuse of fireworks in their area, and their views on the proposals in the draft bill will be very much appreciated. So I refer members to papers 1 to 4, and I'm very pleased to welcome to today's meeting our first panel of witnesses, Assistant Chief Officer Stuart Stevens, Director of Service Delivery with the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, and David Hamilton, Chair of the Scottish Police Federation. Welcome both. And Alistair Hay of the Fireworks Review Group is slightly delayed and will be joining us shortly. So we very much appreciate the time that you've taken to join us this morning. So we'll now just move directly to questions. We've got around about an hour and 15 minutes. So I wonder if I can maybe just open up questions, and I'll maybe come to yourself, Stuart, first, and then David. I really just ask you first off a general question, perhaps to outline your kind of experiences and involvement in the issue of fireworks and pyrotechnics, obviously, in your professional role, and whether you feel that the legislation being proposed in the bill is the right step forward and that the timing is right on this. So maybe come to you first, Stephen. Stuart.
That's OK. Good morning, colleagues. As I say, Stuart Stevens, Assistant Chief Officer and Director of Service Delivery for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. Clearly, as a fire officer of 24 years, I've got considerable experience of fireworks and pyrotechnics, in particular around about the bonfire period, which occurs every year in November. It probably comes as no surprise that fireworks presents quite a considerable challenge for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. And there's essentially three strands to that. First, there's the harm, the danger that it poses to people who use fireworks inappropriately or clearly are not aware of the damage that they may cause. The second is around the antisocial behaviour use of fireworks. And the third, clearly, is the impact on my firefighters and obviously partners from Blue Light Emergency Services, who are obviously subject to antisocial behaviour and the use of fireworks. So every year we see quite considerable number of incidents where fireworks are either fired at emergency services workers or are used to intimidate members of the community, put through letterboxes, smashing car windows and put them into cars, and clearly that presents quite a significant challenge to the fire service, but also quite a considerable safety challenge to members of the community. The impact, you know, is felt every year on the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. It probably is part of a wider antisocial behaviour issue, and it's quite it's not unsurprising that come November the 5th, antisocial behaviour does increase quite considerably, and we sell fireworks quite openly in within shops, and then people can obviously use them as part of that antisocial behaviour. In terms of the legislation, the service absolutely welcome the legislation. We believe it is a step in the right direction in order to mitigate those issues that I've described previously in terms of the use of fireworks. The timing is right as well. We are seeing every year antisocial behaviour increasing and the use of fireworks to, as I say, intimidate or carry out antisocial behaviour increasing all the time. And every year, unfortunately, I have to witness some of my firefighters being injured by fireworks or being intimidated by the use of fireworks all the time. And last year, I was in our control room during bonfire night and was watching on CCTV a number of my crew being attacked by fireworks. Not only that, once the fireworks had run out, the individuals were quite readily able to go and restock by going to the nearest shop and buy more fireworks and then carrying on that behaviour as well. So Thankfully, over the last few years, we've not had a firefighter seriously injured. We've had a number of appliances significantly damaged by fireworks. We've had a number of near misses, and we've had a number of individuals who have been injured, but nothing seriously. However, I do believe that is only a matter of time before that actually happens, and I do understand that my police colleagues have been subject to similar issues as well. So hopefully that answers your question, Convener.
Thanks very much, Stuart. I'll maybe come back to you on a couple of points in relation to the sort of impact on your crews, but I'll just bring in David now.
Thank you, Convener. David Hamilton, I'm Chair of the Scottish Police Federation. I've got 25 years policing service, and the period of time around November is the period when you kind of dread, because you know what's going to happen. It happens every year. We see an escalation in antisocial behaviour and almost the weaponising at times of fireworks, where people are taking fireworks, which they can readily get, and are using them to attack communities, attack police officers responding to that. Over the last few years, we've seen a marked increase in that, and have had a number of had public order deployments put in place just to give the officers protection. The cost to this in terms to officers is quite significant. We have seen officers badly burned with fireworks who have been scarred for life, traumatised by it. We've also had officers who have been temporarily deafened by fireworks. It's something that is almost part of the kind of season that comes through, and it is a consistent problem all my career. This has been a problem. I think it is getting worse though, and our police responses probably since about 2016 have been ramped up significantly in terms of having to respond to this with full public order deployments. By that, what I'm talking about is officers in full riot gear and shields, because that's the only protection they've got that can sustain the degree of violence that's been they're being presented with. And it's not just in one particular area. There are obviously hot spots, but it's certainly across the central belt we see this being a problem. But even on the more rural areas, we do have these issues, and it's perhaps lower level in terms of the scale, but still it's significant, and people are still being attacked with this. So again, just to say, we absolutely welcome this legislation and the controls that are being proposed.
Okay, well, thanks for that. Just a quick follow-up question, if I may, for both of you. You just touched there, David, on, you know, recently you've had to go to the extent of having, for example, a full sort of public order deployment, if you like. So I'll maybe come back to you and ask to what extent the fireworks season, if you like, has impacted on resources, on planning, and ultimately the cost of responding to fireworks and the issues that arise from the use of fireworks.
Yeah, so in terms of the planning element, Convener, the planning for fireworks period starts just after the springtime. We work quite considerably with partners from local authority, the third sector, our colleagues in Police Scotland, to put in place both plans to respond to fireworks period. And I say period because it's not just two or three nights, it's a matter of weeks. But also quite considerable community safety engagement activity that gets taken place in the run-up to Bonfire Night with schools, youth groups, etc., to make sure that we can mitigate that. And also with animals groups, veterinarians and things like that, because we do understand there's quite a significant impact on animals, people with neurodiverse issues. So we do a lot of planning that takes place, both from a response prevention and prevention perspective. Yeah. In terms of the actual response on the night, it's a considerable response that takes place on the night. We will mobilise well over 1,000 appliances over the kind of the hours on bonfire night alone. So if to put that into perspective for you, on average, the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service will mobilise around about 350, 400 times a day on a normal day, and on bonfire night will be well over 1,000 mobilisations will take place. But we also handle thousands more calls that we don't mobilise to because it's control burn and things like that. And that puts considerable pressure on our operations control rooms and obviously our frontline staff. So, as I say, it generally is on the night that we're at that peak. However, in the run-up to it and the days following it, with considerable resource and capacity demands. Can't quantify that into pounds and pence in terms of financial element, but it's considerable in terms of the impact to us. and my colleague talked about rural areas. Most of our rural areas are covered by retained duty officers. It's an absolute keystone of our communities, and they have to mobilise from their primary roles, their primary employment roles, in order to deal with these incidents as well. And clearly that comes at a cost to the service as well.
Mm-hmm. Thanks very much. David, do you want to come in?
Thank you. I can't give you the actual numbers or cost that that's for Police Scotland really to give you. What I can tell you, though, is that, again, this is not just about the 5th of November. This is a season. And that's something which we see, that we have officers taken off other duties and put into our public order units, and they then deployed. So we're taking officers away from other parts of community policing, other parts of the service, to do this, to staff these vans up and to respond to that. But we also have another tier, which is the community police aspect. So again, they are diverting their attentions into dealing with this as preventative work in advance. And that's, another abstraction that sometimes isn't caught by costing. It's if you're doing this, then you're not doing something else. And there's a significant amount of time done with that. And of course, our response officers, who are just absolutely run ragged when it comes to these types of events, because it's call after call after call. Again, Police Scotland be able to give you some idea about the volume of calls, but it's significant.
OK, thanks very much. I'll hand over to Russell. Welcome, Alistair. You've arrived safely, so I'll just let you get settled and hand over to Alistair.
Can I just sincerely apologise? It took me 2.5 hours to drive here from Dundee today, so I'm genuinely embarrassed, but my apologies to the committee.
Don't worry. We're just glad that you've arrived safely. Russell,
hi. Thank you, everyone, for coming to see us. In terms of the season that you refer to, David, how long would that typically last?
I think we normally plan for it to be a number of days. I can't tell you the exact number of days, again, to be honest, because, again, it's an operational planning matter which Police Scotland would make a decision on based upon resourcing, based upon the threat and the intelligence that's coming through. But we expect that to be at least a week to 10 days in general. That's what we'd typically be looking at.
Because from reading a lot of the submissions, there seems to be two key issues. One is the sort of noise element, which lots of people don't like, and then the much more serious deliberate use of fireworks to target either members of the public, property or emergency services. Do you have any stats, either of you, about the number of those types of incidents over the years? Because it does sound like there's been a year-on-year increase, but has it been measured or quantified in any way that you know of?
In terms of what, sorry?
Attacks on yourselves.
Yeah, so I can give you some stats on terms of attacks. So we refer to them as acts of violence, so that encompasses both physical attacks and verbal attacks, and obviously the use of fireworks. So 2018, there was 10 of those on one fire night, six on 2019, and last year that was 7 attacks on firefighters on the night of bonfire night.
2021?
2021, yeah.
Okay.
Some of those resulted in hospitalisation of two individuals as well, not through fireworks but through assault.
Of your
of
employees?
Of firefighters,
Right. So that was 2018, 2019, then it jumps to 2021?
So I can. 2021 was 7, 2020 is 6, 2019 6, 2018 10, 2017 8, and it's kind of a running theme from that on the years previous to that.
Right, indeed, okay. And in terms of this type of behaviour, that only occurs around November the 5th period. It doesn't apply in other periods of the year where fireworks are used to celebrate religious festivals and so on?
So, no, it would be the answer. We do have acts of violence that take place throughout the year, unfortunately. It's just a kind of emerging trend, as my colleagues points out, in terms of attacks on emergency services workers. But with the use of fireworks, it's clearly around about the bonfire period and not other periods where fireworks are available.
Right, OK. Thank you. Happy to pass
fine.
Over. Thank you.
OK, I'll bring in, I think, Rona Mackay. I think I'll bring you in next. Over to you, Rona.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. We've just heard from Stuart and David some alarming evidence about the the consequences of fireworks and on the fire service and on the police service. Could I maybe ask your view on whether you would have preferred an outright ban on fireworks? And if not, why not? And just the issues around that. If I can come to Stuart first, David, and then Alistair, thanks.
It probably comes as no surprise that as a serving fire officer, my personal preference would be a complete ban on fireworks. However, I think we need to look at things in the round, and we need to understand that there are some cultural and religious uses of fireworks, some celebration use of fireworks, and the vast majority of people also use fireworks in a very measured and mature approach and don't engage in antisocial behaviour. So I think this legislation strikes that balance in terms of making it more difficult for people to acquire fireworks, but also making sure that those who do use them more sensibly, and the licensing element encourages people to obviously carry out some training and how to use them beforehand, go through a process which makes it slightly more challenging to buy fireworks, which is good, and put some control around about them. So I think this does strike that balance between appropriate use and misuse of fireworks.
Thank you. David?
Yes, thank you. I think fireworks are safe if used properly and safely. What we're talking about here is the behaviours. And the legislation as we view it that's proposed seems to be taking, a very balanced approach to it in terms of that individual right for people to be able to use fireworks and celebrate in an appropriate and responsible way, but at the same time dealing with those who don't. And that's the focus of our concern, is those who don't. And I think this legislation does, in a proportionate way, put some kind of tiering on it, whereby we're encouraging people, yes, of course, use this, but I suppose it's like cars, isn't it? If I was a road safety person, I could say, well, I don't want to have cars, but that's not appropriate. I want people to be able to have cars, but they need people to drive it. And that's the key bit. And that's how I think this is a proportional way of dealing with it. I don't know if we're going to be talking about pyrotechnics separately, but again, there's a slight nuances within that as well, because, for pyrotechnics, that is a problem that causes us, even more problems all year round. And I think that's something
I think my colleagues do have some questions on that later in the session. Thanks. Thank you. Alistair, would you like to comment?
In terms of the working group, we had a very clear terms of reference, and it wasn't actually to consider an outright ban on fireworks, though. What we do know is that in the public consultations, this was something that actually featured very heavily, many people calling for an outright ban. So it was inevitable when we came to the review that it was something that actually was discussed. And our number one recommendation was not at this time to bring in an outright ban. As my colleagues have already said, what we were looking for here is a balanced approach, where the enjoyment that many people and their cultural issues as well, the enjoyment that many people have from fireworks can still be maintained whilst understanding the distress it brings to others and the downright criminality that happens on occasions, to try and strengthen the legislation, the preventative approach around that. I think what we also tried to do in the working group is move from anecdote. There's many stories told about the harm that fireworks actually caused, and what we sought to do was to create as strong an evidence base as we possibly could, and we did that through gathering all the available evidence here within Scotland, and also commissioning work where we gathered evidence from countries that have strengthened their legislation around fireworks in recent years. And it was interesting that that there is always a potential with legislation for unintended consequences. And some of the evidence from countries that had actually banned fireworks actually brought forward more of the unintended consequences, such as a black market being created. So getting that balance right, for all the reasons that my colleagues have said, but also that proportionality to try and ensure that we don't invite some of the unintended consequences, and we actually derive the benefits from the report and from the proposed bill that's going through.
Thank you. That's very interesting. Thank you, convener. That's me.
Thanks very much.
Can I just provide a point of clarity? Sorry, I think I misrepresented the numbers before, Mr. Finlay. So just for clarity, in 2021, we had 14 acts of violence over the period of bonfire, the bonfire period, and in 2020 that was 17, of which 13 were actually on bonfire night itself. So apologies, I misread those stats. So, and just to put that in the context, that's 40% of the acts of violence that took place per year happened in the November period. Yeah. So the vast majority happened in November. So apologies for that, Mr. Finlay.
Thank you. Okay, thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Jamie Green. I think you've maybe got a couple of questions, maybe for Alistair, around the review group. So I'll just hand over to you.
Thank you, and good morning. And don't worry, we've all had that crossing to deal with over the years. The old one and the new one, I should add. I just want to get a feel for the Firework Review Group, because it played an integral part of the formation of the legislation that we're analysing as a committee. And essentially, I just want to get a feel from you as to how we've ended up where we are in terms of the proposal. So first of all, could you talk a little bit about the volume of recommendations that you came up with, specifically if they were unanimous decisions that were reached by the review group, and if they were not, which of them were perhaps the more controversial, or indeed were decided on via majority rather than unanimously, and if they were by majority, by how much, and who dissented from those specific recommendations?
Yeah, thank you very much for that. Really, the genesis of this is for a number of years, people have been raising concerns about fireworks within their communities. And I think things like social media, where you can immediately capture what's happening in your community, post it online, and let the world see what's happening. I think that type of activity has brought into sharp focus some of the very unwanted aspects around Bonfire Night in particular. So there was calls coming, you know, for change. Change was needed. And Scottish Government went out. There was a public consultation. That consultation had a huge response, over 16,000 people. And overwhelmingly, what the public was looking for is change, for more protection from the harms. But at the same time, there is that question of the legitimate use of fireworks and the enjoyment that many people derive from it. So, following on from the consultation, it was decided to build on the types of proposals that were highlighted within that consultation. So, key stakeholders from, you know, across the health, across from veterans, from local government, you know, from animal welfare, from the emergency services, but also from the industry. They were all asked on a voluntary basis if they would come together, and I was asked if I would chair this group as an independent chair, which I was, of course, more than happy to do so. So we had a broad group of people, you know, from interested parties. What we wanted to do, I mentioned this earlier, is move from many of the anecdotes and some of the, you know, the dramatic things that you see reported in the media and through social media, and we wanted to create as strong an evidence base as we possibly could. So we really started out by thinking, right, well, what are the options? You know, what are people asking for? And we ran a workshop where we had an options appraisal around all the things, looking at the benefits and perhaps the disbenefits, the disadvantages that may arise if we took those actions. So we worked through that quite you know, systematically, and everybody engaged in this. And from that, we came to, as you see, the number of recommendations. That's where most of the recommendations had their genesis, from that workshop through doing that options appraisal. And at that point, everybody, really was consenting that these are the areas that we really ought to be focusing on. So we took this forward. We continued to strengthen the evidence base. You know, a lot of the data you've been asking colleagues in Police Scotland, colleagues in the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, also the NHS, the British Veterinary Association. We got all the evidence that they could bring to bear. And if I'm being honest, one of the challenges is there's not always, that much analysis and evidence out there. But bringing it together from so many different bodies, that enabled you to lay that together to form a picture on which you could start to base your judgment. So we worked through bringing in the evidence, giving everybody an opportunity to present their evidence for others to question it. And then through that, we honed and toned, if that's the right expression, the recommendations that were coming through. When it came to the final report, and we highlight it in there, really it was the British Fireworks Association are the only people who could not sign up to it at the end of the day. We had a very broad consensus that these were the right recommendations. And I understand their perspective. You know, they're coming from it as they're running businesses. They're a very responsible organisation. So is the British Pyrotechnics Association. They brought a lot to the working group. They pointed us into areas that we really ought to be considering. And we found that extremely helpful. They have good codes of practice. And we've tried to recognise all of that within the report. And that's why we have recommendations in there about doing business impacts, about having that concern around unintended consequences and making sure that the intended benefits are derived by looking in 3 to 5 years' time, you know, to make sure that the benefits are there, and if there's any unintended consequences, how do we deal with those? So that's a sorry for the long answer, but that's a broad approach, and we absolutely had consensus with, you know, that exception that I've pointed out, but they did contribute extremely positively, and I think they influenced heavily the report in a good way.
Excellent, thank you. And I do appreciate that was a long answer, because you giving us the backdrop of how you've got to where you are required that explanation. But I guess where a range of options would have been available to you. It strikes me, though, however, just as a little bit concerning, and it is my only point of concern from the outset, is that the industry which will be affected most by the regulation is the one that did not sign up to the recommendations, which is an odd place to be in. And equally, if you look at the consultation itself, given that the three strands are the sale, the purchase and the use of fireworks, it seems to me that the support is high around control of purchase using a licence scheme, sitting at 84% of respondents. That wanes slightly when it comes to use of fireworks and restrictions around that, down to 67%, and even further wanes down to 64% when you start to get around restrictions of sale of fireworks, which perhaps is where a lot of the issues came with the association industry. Is that not an issue for you, that the people who, you know, who will go out of business or you know, most directly affected immediately by legislation don't agree with the way that we're proposing to tackle the problem?
If you look at the support, even the lowest figure, I think it said 64% there, is considerable report as, you know, support for that change. It's well over half the population. You know, I think it passes that test. And of course, you know, we understand that people have concerns. We from the industry, and that's why we've made one of the recommendations, of course, to do that full business impact. But you've also got to put it on the other side of it as well, that these controls are to ensure that people can still enjoy fireworks safely. That's it. We're not taking away that. But some of the, you know, outrageous attacks on emergency services and some of the really harrowing evidence that we gathered in the form of case studies from the NHS, where children are maimed, disabled for life. You have to balance that against that. So I think in the report, we have recognised where the industry were coming from, but I think that is outweighed by the public support and the downsides of the misuse of fireworks. So we've tried to strike a balance there.
And I guess my final question is there, and I am absolutely playing devil's advocate, because I you know, the evidence that we've heard on attacks on emergency services, on the effect that they have in our community, these are abhorrent, and everyone acknowledges and accepts that. But people will question us if we're using a sledgehammer to crack a nut here. You know, is there a reason why we are introducing laws to restrict across the whole of the population the purchase, the sale and the use of fireworks, when it is a minority of people who misuse and abuse those in the same way that people misuse kitchen knives or alcohol and the other ways in which third-party objects are used to fuel antisocial behaviour? Are we punishing the majority because of the minority? Now, that's a very valid question that we'll have to answer as we progress the legislation.
And it was something that the group absolutely wrestled with, but because what they want as an outcome from this through the discussions is that we got the balance right on that, so that legitimate enjoyment that people have of fireworks could still be maintained, whilst at the same time, you know, those that would choose to misuse and abuse fireworks and create the harm that we see would be made more difficult, you know, because we understand, you know, if people are going to choose to absolutely abuse something, it can be difficult, you know, to stop it. So we absolutely wanted to get that balance right within the report. We don't think it's a sledgehammer here. And if you think about, you know, the fact that you're going to need a license, you're going to have to do some online training. Some of the evidence that we looked at, it was genuine people who wanted to enjoy the fireworks and had accidents with them. So actually, some of these people, you know, with a little bit of online training, a bit more forethought and not a spontaneous event to use the fireworks, will actually be safer in their enjoyment of fireworks. So taking that across there, we feel and really strive to get the balance right on that.
Thank you. I'll maybe come back in later. Thank you.
Perfect. Okay, that's great. Thanks for that. And likewise, I'll come back on a couple of points around injuries if we've got time later on. So I think we've got some questions around the sort of proposals around licensing. So maybe bring you in, Russell, and then I'll bring Rona Mackay after Russell.
Thank you. Yeah, we visited Blackburn on Monday, yesterday, and heard evidence from people about the problems there. There was adults effectively supplying young people with fireworks. There was a guy in a white van that apparently every year pops up and does a roaring trade, and another adult who apparently sort of stockpiles in his own home. Now, Alistair, you've already referred to the fact that an outright ban would potentially cause a greater black market. I just wonder if the licensing will be sufficient to stop Blackburn's white van man.
Can I come in this?
Yep.
First, we also visited Blackburn. This is you know, a community that has felt under siege in and around Bonfire Night, and that community has worked hard with prevention and distraction, to prevent local, predominantly young people getting involved in this. And clearly somebody in the white van has seen an opportunity there. And this is one of the areas where actually the industry was absolutely in agreement with the recommendations, because it was everybody felt it was slightly confusion within the current legislation as to whether or not it was illegal to give fireworks to under 18s. So the recommendation was to strengthen that and to clarify it, so there is no doubt that was the intention behind the recommendation. So if somebody rocks up in a white van and starts, you know, selling to young people, there is no question whatsoever that is wrong in anybody's mind, and hopefully within the legislation there will be no question, and that will make the role of, you know, colleagues within Police Scotland easier. And if it's communicated properly, it strengthens the local communities, because they will understand that and they can call on the appropriate authorities to assist them in the right way.
What about from a policing perspective, is there a concern that taking any measures such as licensing, you're going to create a bigger black market?
I think what we need to be able to do is have the tools to deal with the problem. And, you know, that this is a key bit that we can use to try and make things better and to tackle a real problem. If we know that White Van Man in Blackburn is doing that, then we can deal with White Van Man and stop it happening, because we know that's the root cause of the problem. It doesn't mean that we're going to stop every white van in Blackburn. It just allows us to get the right one and deal with that, you know, clearly. And there's no ambiguity. There's no difference. We're on a particular focus to do something. So I think that power is really important in itself. In terms of the black market aspect of it, I think that's something we just deal with, and that some people will choose to break the law as long as it's communicated and people are clear that what is acceptable, what's not acceptable, what's lawful and unlawful, then there'll be no excuse, and we deal with that. But again, I think it's the starting point for me has to be you need to have the tools to do it, and we don't have those tools yet.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. I'll bring in Rona Mackay. I think you were looking to ask some questions around licensing as well, Rona.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I've got a couple of questions I'd like to ask Alistair and Stuart, and then a separate question for David. So my first question is to Alistair and Stuart, which I'm going to just sort of wrap into one, was would you say that, regarding the fee, a fee that's been charged, could that be seen as sort of pricing people out of being able to enjoy fireworks if some people just simply can't afford the fee? Second question, it was initially proposed that the licence be valid for 12 months, and then the intention is for it to be valid for 5 years. 5 years being quite a long time, a lot can happen during that time, and, you know, someone could during that time have a criminal conviction or whatever. Does that concern you? So if I could come to Stuart first and then Alistair.
Probably not within the scope of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service to comment on the fee element of that, Ms Mackay. I think that's probably more for Scottish Government and for the group that's been done. In terms of your second point around about the fee period, the licence period, apologies. Yeah, I take on board your point in terms of there may be potential that somebody has a criminal offence within that period, and that perhaps needs to be reflected on the licence. But again, it's probably for my Scottish Government colleagues or my police colleague to comment on that, Ms McKay.
Thank you. Alistair?
Yeah, thank you. I think the first comment I would make on this is, in terms of the fee and the duration, the group didn't look at that type of detail. How do you operationalise the recommendations? That was something that a lot of detailed work has to go on. My expectation and understanding is that colleagues that work within Scottish Government would do that. But I think it is a point well made and needs to be considered appropriately in terms of people being priced out of enjoying fireworks. One of the biggest things that we would hope for is that people actually move away from their own private bonfire displays. If they want to do it, then the balance should be right and they should enjoy it. But it's encouraging organised public displays where all the right safety precautions are there. The displays are often spectacular, and we would hope more people would find that enjoyment down that route. That was quite a strong direction to travel that I think the group were all supportive of.
Thank you. David, if I could come to you, feel free to answer those questions if you like, but I'd also like to ask you, if you have any concerns about how the proposed licensing scheme will be policed, is this going to create a big challenge for you? And if you've been having discussions with the Scottish Government on this, I'm not sure whether the onus would fall on yourselves or local authorities in that respect, but obviously the policing of it, if somebody doesn't have a licence, I guess would fall to you. If I could have your view on that, please.
Certainly, yes. Just briefly on the cost aspect, I think fireworks are probably the definition of burning money, literally. I don't have a huge amount of sympathy for adding some licensing onto what is actually very expensive thing to do with fireworks anyway. So I think there's that's something that we should factor into proportionality of it. But also on the finance aspect, it's important that we would suggest that there should be some kind of self-funding tied to this, that if we are doing this, that it should be able to fund itself. Because, again, with public services as they are, anything additional is going to stretch us. You know, that is the reality of this. So that there needs to be some kind of loop back in to support public services, policing, fire, with the costs of implementing this legislation. So what that actually looks like, I'm sure there's people with spreadsheets can give you that answer. It won't necessarily be me. In terms of the licensing aspect itself, I think one of the key things we have is about having the technology to be able to do so. We're in a much, much better position now with the access to digital technologies and getting access to the some of the licensing information which we have in our own systems. So that there is a question we have in terms of just that interface between our licensing systems and the ultimate government licensing system, and just making sure that we know who's doing what and what the protocols for sharing are and how that's updated and how regularly, because this requires, if we're going to be stopping and dealing with people who have fireworks, who will probably receive licences in a very short period of time and quite recently, we need to be able to be in a place where we can respond to that appropriately and know that for sure that they are accredited and dealing with that. I think the other thing which we are quite keen to look at is this is about communications again, and this is covered in the control zones. We think there needs to be signage, proper signage and communication. We didn't really see much of that in the bill, and I think that's something that needs to be developed a bit further, so that people need to know that they can't use fireworks in a particular area. People need to know what the legislation is here, so that there's a big communication piece here. Some people I've spoken to already have actually said that, well, fireworks are going to be banned next year. And again, that's the wrong message in itself. So I think we need to get ahead of the game here, would be my suggestion.
Mm-hmm. That's a really good point. If I could just ask you, I mean, this might seem a bit basic, but just the practicalities of the scheme. I mean, do you envisage your officers, you know, going up to someone who's having a firework display, say in a small village or whatever, and saying, "Can I see your license, please?" Is that how it's going to work? How will you know whether they've got a license or not?
I don't honestly know, and I think we'll have to take direction from the chief constable as to how he wishes to deal with that. There's probably going to be a degree here of response to complaints, and again, I think that the people will respond to this by, we'll have calls saying somebody's having a fireworks display. And scaring my cat, my dog, whatever, and we will then respond to that. And at that point, that's when it would be a check to make sure everything's in order, and just as we do just now. But I don't imagine we'll be in a position of going around and being, you know, proactive fireworks police in terms
controlling.
Of
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay. Thanks, convener.
Thanks very much. I'll come back to Russell, and then I'll bring in Katie.
Yeah, there was a quick question about licensing that I should have asked Giles earlier on. Sorry about that. If these licences last for 5 years, what would the mechanism be for having them revoked? What grounds would there be to do so? Or indeed, has that been built into it? Do you know? Would it just be for a criminal conviction, or would it be for misuse or supplying others or something of that nature?
Yeah, I apologise, but again, this is the detailed work that you know, civil servants are undertaking at this moment in time, and there'd be other people that would be best placed to answer the detail on it. It was the principle and the concept of creating more control. We had evidence from other parts of the world where that had actually worked, and it had shifted the way, you know, from that spontaneous, if you're, you know, in the shops, you see a box of fireworks, you think, I'll just pick that up and then, you know, put on a little display for the family tonight. It was to try and create that shift away, you know, from this, you know, that spontaneity, because, you know, it's indisputable that fireworks can be dangerous, you know, either because people misuse them or they just don't understand how to use them properly. So it was to make it more of a thought through process, and that's what the intent behind the licensing type. And of course, when you start talking about licensing, you know, you need to make sure that you're excluding people who potentially, you know, through past behaviours, are more likely to misuse them. That's, I would imagine, how it's been taken forward.
So presumably needs something of that nature in it once it's developed.
Yes.
You'd agree with that?
I would agree with that, and that would be the thinking behind the recommendation that was made.
Right, thank you.
Okay, thanks. I'll bring in Katie now.
Thank you. And if I could ask a question perhaps of Mr Hamilton, who's already commented on the fee being charged and has rightly pointed out that fireworks aren't being banned completely. So would he agree that the fee itself and the level of the fee could be seen as pricing the majority of firework users out of using and enjoying fireworks responsibly?
I wouldn't say so. I mean, again, it depends what the fee is. But when you are literally sending your money up into the sky and exploding it, it's kind of, that is perhaps in the luxury end of living in some ways. You know, it's, I think there needs to be a sensible approach to what, you know, let's not be too feared about what that cost should be. It should be something that's responsible for what we're doing. And it's, I don't think it's unreasonable to ask people to, when there are other options, such as public displays, there. If people choose to have that in a private event, then people need to perhaps accept that there's a cost that comes with that. And I don't think it's unreasonable to do so, particularly, as I say, given the cost of these of private fireworks.
Mm-hmm. So perhaps it's down to the kind of groups that are being asked to pay this fee, would you say?
I think if everyone's been asked to pay for it, then that, it just, I think it makes it quite clear that if you wish to do a private event, then that's something which you, it's up to, over to yourself to sort of accept that is part of the cost of doing it. Just as if I want to drive a car, I've got to pay for a driver's license, but I can take a bus. You know, I don't have to do that. It's a choice to do so, and it's not unreasonable to pay, you know, again, quite a lot of money for a driver's license, but the cost of a car is quite significant. So I think it's just in terms of, there's got to be a kind of proportional link there between the cost of, when we look at the cost of fireworks and the cost of a licence, we shouldn't be too scared about making it, you know, on terms of level.
And do either of the other witnesses feel that they have any comments in relation to the level of the fee to ensure that perhaps some of the genuine collective organisations that are wanting to, you know, organise events aren't priced out? If you like, the legitimate and responsible use of fireworks is allowed?
It's not something that the group looked at. So if I was making a comment on it, it would only be a personal comment, and I feel that I should represent the report here today. So apologies for that.
Thank you.
And certainly from my perspective, and I think both my colleagues have made the point really well, in terms of anything that encourages people to go to, you know, displays, organised displays, is a real benefit of that. You know, so and the service fully support that approach.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to bring in Colette Stevenson. I think you're looking to ask some questions around the sort of restrictions on use and supply. So over to you, Colette.
Yeah, thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel, and thanks very much for your written submission so far. In regards to the bill, it introduces various restrictions on the days and times when fireworks can be sold and used. Are you content that the proposed restrictions strike an appropriate balance between allowing people to enjoy fireworks and seeking to sort of reduce the misuse of fireworks as well? And if I can put that question to Alistair first, and then Stuart, and then David. Thanks.
Do you want to bring in someone in particular, Colette?
She just asked.
I beg your pardon. Sorry, Convener. Alistair first, and then.
yeah. I do feel that it does strike the right balance in there. The periods in which the, you know, the sale of fireworks will be allowed are respecting, you know, the existing traditions, and there's an element of equality, diversity, inclusion in there because it respects other cultures, so it gives that opportunity. I think one of the biggest challenges that was put to the group is if people know that fireworks events are going to take place, then they can take their own precautions. So I know you'll be taking evidence later from the British Veterinary Association, but the number of people that will go and visit their vet to get a form of mild sedation for their animals around that time, because they know that things are going to be happening, so they can plan and they can take controls. They could take control of the situation. Whereas if you did not have those restrictions, those restrictions in terms of the periods of the year when the fireworks can be sold, then it's more likely that they'll be used and the disturbance element of it, the harm element of it, will come as a surprise and can therefore be exacerbated. So that was a major thinking behind that, is to allow the wider community to understand when they have to take an element of responsibility so others can enjoy the use of fireworks appropriately. So that was the thinking behind it, and I think we've got the balance right there because it respects tradition, it respects, you know, the diverse country we live in, so all can enjoy appropriately, but the unintended, the unexpected is limited.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
If I could maybe put that question to Stuart.
Thanks. I think Alistair makes that point really well in terms of the impact of people and animals, and obviously provides an opportunity to put in place appropriate mitigations for that. I guess my only concern with the timescales would be, and we've highlighted it in our submission, is the potential for people to stockpile or store fireworks between the periods where they can purchase them. And I think that there'll need to be adequate detail within the licensing and the purchasing and the selling process to make sure that doesn't take place. And certainly the service will provide adequate community safety engagement advice and guidance to make sure that doesn't happen. But that will be the biggest issue for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, to make sure that doesn't happen.
Okay, thanks, Stuart. Okay, if I could just ask David what his views are on that.
Yeah, I think the timing's quite a... the worst time to have the 5th of November is a Wednesday, because you get the weekend before and you get the weekend after. And trying to plan that from a policing perspective, and as a former events planner, we used to just, you know, hold our head and our hands over this one, because when is going to be, you know, the bonfire night celebrations? And that's the challenging piece. So when you get a Wednesday, it could go either way, and actually usually goes both ways. So you do need to have some flexibility within the legislation to allow it to cater for the Saturday before, but equally the Saturday after. But I think where we would probably encourage things to happen would be having a hard stop, so that it finishes. It shouldn't tail on. I mean, if we go back to the cultural aspect of this, so that, you know, this is about, I suppose ultimately it's about blowing up the House of Commons, but this is a kind of annual celebration that needs, there's no excuse for it tailing on. And once the kind of cluster of organised events finish, then that's when it needs to stop. And that should, of course, be preceded by the supply. There shouldn't be supplying fireworks after 5th of November, I would suggest, because at that time you should know what you're doing, and it stops that impulsiveness. And again, it encourages people to plan ahead and think about public events as opposed to private events.
Okay, thanks, David. And again, I'm posing this question to three of you. A number of the local authorities as well have questioned whether these restrictions were necessary and proportionate. Could you just maybe outline why they feel that such restrictions are absolutely necessary? And if I just go back to Alistair again there.
Yeah, we involved the local authorities, throughout this process. They were represented, you know, via COSLA, and we actually had some specialism from Trading Standards. I think we should also remember the role that Trading Standards play in all this. And like all, you know, public services, they have finite resource and it has to be prioritised. So it does help that there's a finite period of time where they can make sure they do the, and work really hard. I think they do over 650 visits during that bonfire period to outlets that are selling them to make sure they're doing it legitimately. So it helps local authorities to prioritise their resources is what we considered, certainly within the discussion and within the group. And in terms of that proportionality, it is about, and we've got evidence from places like Berlin where they'd introduced no firework zones, etc., at the behest of communities, that it does make a difference in terms of meeting communities' expectations, giving them the opportunities to go to organised displays or appropriately licensed displays and not having their lives blighted by the misuse of it. So within local authority areas, with the consent of their communities, what we think we're doing in terms of proportionality is giving them flexibility and options to take it forward so that you don't, the term that was used earlier, use a sledgehammer to crack a nut. You focus within big local authority areas on the areas where history has shown you, experience has shown you that misuse is likely to take place and communities are asking for assistance and help.
Okay, no, thank you. I'm just wondering if David or Stuart have any comments on that. I know that both of you work closely with the local authorities as well.
Yeah, perhaps just build on some of the points that Alice has made there. Not only do trading standards have to use resources over the period where fireworks are available or currently all the time, my fire safety enforcement officers also have to carry out legislative fire safety enforcement and audits over that period. Essentially, I have to divert them from doing, for example, care homes to doing shops that sell fireworks to make sure that they're meeting the legislation and things like that as well. So it's not appropriate use of my resources. And having a finite period where fireworks are available allows me to do better resource management in terms of that finite resource. I think the other part is around about the operational impact and operational planning for me. Where fireworks are available throughout the year, we could come across fireworks in any premise and quite considerable amounts of those. I've been to an incident where fireworks have been involved, the storage of fireworks. I don't want to go to another one, and I certainly don't want my firefighters to be exposed to them because of the dangers that they pose. And I'm sure people have seen similar incidents on TV across the world where fireworks are involved. So having a finite period where fireworks are available would mitigate the impact of that to make sure that there's not large storage throughout the year of fireworks, aside from those individuals and companies who are allowed to do so.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. Thanks. Just briefly, I think it's probably important to go back to where this all started, and it was because of a problem. And it was a problem in our communities across Scotland where the communities were getting terrorised. Emergency services workers were getting injured, and there was a big cry for assistance and for a change. And we can only do so much. And this is about giving us further measures as responders to that to say we'll be able to deal with this problem. And without those measures, we're kind of stuck where we are. And this is continuing to happen the same way each year. Now, obviously, with the pandemic, that's changed things. But even then, there were events going on. And so we really need these tools to allow us to tackle this and make a difference for our communities. It's not something that we can do with the existing tool set.
Okay, thanks. Okay. I've got no further questions, convener. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much. We've got a fair bit of interest in this topic, so I'm going to bring in Jamie and then Russell and then Fulton. If you can make your questions and responses succinct, because we've still got another couple of areas that we're interested in exploring. So, Jamie.
Thank you, convener. So, the bill as proposed contains five periods of restrictions around the sale and the use. Do you think there's any potential that these might be deemed as quite arbitrary? So, for example, they include religious festivals such as Diwali and the Sikh festival, but they don't include other religious festivals, for example, such as Eid or Hanukkah. Do you think this might be open to challenge in the future? And should the legislation therefore allow flexibility for other religious or secular organisations to ask for exemptions from the restrictions?
I think we tried to make it very clear in the report that we understand we live in a multicultural country and respect for traditions of all should be foremost in the thoughts of anybody taking the recommendations forward. And if inadvertently people who traditionally would be using fireworks within their tradition have been excluded, I think doing a proper impact assessment to make sure that all aspects of equality, diversity and inclusion are taken into consideration would be the right way forward.
Does anyone else have a view on that? No. Okay, thank you. And therefore, as proposed, because you talked a little bit about giving flexibility to local authorities, do you think it would be beneficial, therefore, that individuals, groups, organisations, religious or otherwise, out with of the sale and use periods that are defined in the legislation, could perhaps on a local authority by local authority basis, under the other measures in the scheme, apply for exception for specific events. For example, I think of Edinburgh Festival or Jubilee Festivals or other types of dates and times and events that may happen out with of these, which may then therefore make it easier to cover off the issue of other people who may feel excluded from this very specific and narrow dates that have been included in the legislation. Would there be any benefit to that, perhaps?
I think that the overarching drive is to change the culture in terms of the use of fireworks to make sure that, as I've said earlier, people think about it. It's much more planned, and it's not as spontaneous, and it doesn't give as much opportunity to those to access fireworks who may misuse them. That's the overarching drive in this. In terms of the diversity and respect in that, I think I've already made the groups and indeed more. I know I'm not speaking for myself. My own view on that. Clear. In terms of things like the Edinburgh Festival, etc., then what I would really be encouraging there, and it already exists, is the organised displays. And my understanding is that we're looking to encourage that. We're not looking to limit it. This is more on the over-the-counter almost sale of fireworks. So I don't think it would be restrictive in dealing with these. Fantastic events that happen in this great city. It's not aimed at that.
Okay, thank you.
I was going to ask a very similar question to what Jamie asked, so it's a bit of a damp squib now. sorry about that. And I suppose it was the first part is who decides these proposed dates. This was part of the review group's decision making. Is that correct?
Well, we made recommendation. We didn't make decisions. And I think what needs to be thought about, and I know it has been thought about, is what's the intent behind that recommendation, and then how do you operationalise that? How do you make it a practical reality? And people I know are working hard within Scottish Government, to do that. And this is part of that process. So if there's anything that is not understood, anything that has been missed, there's an opportunity to highlight those and consider them appropriately.
I mean, one thing that occurs to me is if you think back to when I was younger, fireworks night was the only night of the year that fireworks were used. New Year's become a thing. There's various religious festivals now. And in sort of defining it in this way, the unintended consequence could be others come along and stake their claim to other dates in the calendar. And in fact, you're almost having a year-round encouraging the use of fireworks. Is there not a potential for that?
there's always potential, you know, but I think the key for me in this is what is the intent behind it, and whatever authority is given, ultimately the responsibility to license the sale, etc. They have to remember the intent behind this, and if they're going to make a decision to agree or allow something, make that a conscious decision. You know, understand the benefits, understand the risks, but always remember that what we're trying to do here is allow people to enjoy fireworks safely, but to limit the opportunity for misuse of firework, and absolutely to limit the opportunities, you know, for people to be injured by fireworks, even accidentally.
Okay, thank you.
Fulton, I'll bring you in, and then we'll move on.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I've been damn squiddied, but if that's such a term, by Jamie as well, I'm afraid. But I will pick up on the line of questioning, which is, like others have had around about the dates that have been given, because I do have some concern that these could be open to challenge, as other members have said, and I would like to be reassured as we move through the legislation that there's not something more we can do to help the intent of this bit of the legislation. So, you know, I know local authorities are able to, you know, have organised displays and the like, but do you think there's an argument for local authorities having more power in terms of setting specific dates for their area? You know, because I think as all three of the previous speakers have asked about Mr. Hayes, you know, there is obviously other religious events in the years. There's obviously one-off events as well that might come up that might be important to people. You know, so I wonder if you've got any thoughts on local authorities having a sort of, you know, application scheme, if you like. Thanks.
Maybe bring in Alistair on that.
Yeah. Again, there is the opportunity for people to go to organised displays and for the local authorities to allow those. This is, you know, mainly a focus on the, you know, across the counter sale to members of the public. That is the big focus on this. And as I've already said, you know, making sure that a proper equality impact assessment and the other types of assessment that support that take place is an important way to make sure that nobody is inadvertently excluded from this. But the intent is absolutely there to protect, you know, people from the misuse of fireworks, from the injuries that fireworks can cause, but allow them to enjoy fireworks. So any way that the controls are taken forward has to absolutely make sure it keeps that intent behind any decision that they make, and that decision has to be a conscious one based on the risks and the benefits.
Okay, thanks very much. Are you wanting to bring in anyone else, Fulton?
No, I'm quite happy with that, Convener, because I think the previous questioners actually covered the main thrust of what I was going to ask about as well. So thanks.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm just watching the time, and I would very much like to cover off the other sort of themes that we've got this morning around control zones. And pyrotechnics. So I'll move on to control zones, and I'll bring in Rona and then Russell. Rona.
Thanks, Convener. Just a brief question for me on it. Firework control zones, can you just clarify who decides those? Is it the local authority, and are they guided by the local communities? And do you think they're realistic and workable, is basically my question. If I could come to Alistair first.
This was something that was very much asked for by communities. We've already mentioned Blackburn. We also spoke to communities in West Pilton here in Edinburgh. And when we went to Blackburn, they absolutely felt that in and around bonfire night stroke season, they were under siege, they were under threat. So that discussion really focused on giving the power, if that's the right expression, to the communities. It should be at the ask of communities, because they want to live and enjoy their area, don't they? So it was asked for by them, and the group thought that is where the ask should come from. That's where the power should lie. But obviously, you need an authority to control that, and it would be the local authority at the behest of the communities. That was the thinking that was behind the recommendation that went within there. Will it work? One of the challenges is that a lot of the legislation that is being proposed has been applied in some other parts of the world, other parts of Europe, but in relatively recent times. So doing the full evaluation of its effectiveness, it does take time, because things are very impactful in the first year or two, and then they can drift. We understand that. So we recommend that we come back and evaluate, in a few 3 to 5 years' time. But certainly early evidence from Berlin, Amsterdam, when they've put these zones in place, is that they do work and the communities benefit from them. But that's the early feedback.
Thanks, Alistair. Stuart?
Yeah, I think, again, it's another tool in the toolbox that can be deployed, and particularly in areas where there's high operational demand and areas where there's been high levels of antisocial behaviour, So the service would absolutely work with the local authority and partners in Police Scotland as part of that preventative planning element and the community safety engagement to consider fireworks control zones. And I think the other element of fireworks control zones is where there's potential for animals or veterans' homes or whatever it may be to be impacted upon by the noise of fireworks as well. So it's not just purely about the antisocial behaviour element, there's also that kind of wider community safety element.
There's not a danger of just moving the problem elsewhere. If people in a certain community are in a zone that they can't use them, would they just go somewhere else? I guess that's a hypothetical question, really. But
well, hopefully we'd perhaps encourage, like we said before, people to go to organised professional displays as opposed to having, pop-up displays within communities, so it may be another approach to that.
Yeah. Thank you. David?
Yeah, I just echo what the other witnesses have said. I mean, I think, again, in the core thing that runs through our local authorities and our public services is the human rights aspect of this, and it's going to be proportionate. So we're not going to just suddenly designate an area because there's going to have to be something that backs that up. So I'm confident that we will get to a position where we will where these zones are used, they are needed, and that just it goes back to that appropriate proportionality and another tool to allow us to get to the outcome, which is trying to deal with a problem which we're all clear about and aware about, and I think it's helping these communities that way. So it's not a carte blanche.
Okay, thank you. Thanks,
Kimberly. Do you mind if I just add another point to this? It's really just to underscore what Stuart said about this is another tool in the toolkit. This is about trying to exercise a positive cultural change in Scotland in the approach to how people use and enjoy fireworks. And the legislative aspect of it is extremely important. It's probably the key tool, but around that is also the education, the prevention strategies. There is a lot of other work that would complement the core legislation, so there's no one individual thing that will resolve the problem or problems. There's no one thing that will exercise that big cultural change, that positive cultural change that we're seeking. It's looking at this in the round is something I feel that is important. So Stuart made that point, but I felt I wanted to reinforce it because it was certainly something that the group understood and tried to convey in their final report.
Thanks for that. I know we're just a bit tight for time, but I would like to just come in on a point in particular that you made, Alistair. As you know, that we had a visit to Blackburn and met with the Bonfire Night Action Group on Monday. And they spoke quite a bit about control zones. And a couple of the points that they made were around the sort of stigma of living in or near a zone, but particularly in a zone. And there was some sort of commentary around the issue of, and I think Rona asked about it, around the issue of sort of them displacing sort of bad behaviour, if you like. So you have a control zone, but it just essentially moves bad behaviour elsewhere. So I'm just interested in if you've got any further comments on that. And also from the policing side of things, just what your thoughts would be on how they are policed. So I'll maybe come to you, Alistair, and then bring in David.
Yeah, the last thing that anybody would ever want to do is stigmatise any individual or any grouping or community. And that is why I think it's important to understand that in terms of the control zones, it should be the communities are the instigators of this, because they then have the power and they understand the potential implications of it as well as the potential benefits of it. In terms of the question of displacement, when we went to Blackburn, one of the things that they actually told us is that people come from other communities, almost bus into Blackburn, you know, because it had developed that reputation, as it were, for a place where there would be, you know, the opportunity to misuse fireworks and other types of antisocial behaviour. So there is always a problem of displacement, but that is why there is no one thing that will resolve this issue. It is about trying to restrict, you know, those people that would seek to be displaced into other communities to abuse firework. You know, if you've got a licensing system that includes training, if you've got restricted hours, all of these things help the situation, allied to the point that was just made earlier about education, about prevention tactics, distractions, all that type of stuff has to come together to mitigate against that potential for displacement of a problem.
Thanks for that. David?
Thanks, yeah. On the displacement aspect, I mean, I think what we're talking about here are people who are not behaving well. So we've got people who are essentially causing antisocial behaviour, and the Blackburn people are travelling because they know there's going to be trouble and issues there. The displacement thing, I don't think, is so much of an issue because it's not like if they're going to behave badly, they're going to behave badly wherever they are. I don't think that the zone in itself will have much of a preventative aspect from those intent and causing problems. What it will do, however, though, is give us, again, that magic word, the tools to be able to deal with those people appropriately and robustly, if necessary, in a way that we don't have just now.
OK, thanks very much for that. We'll just quickly move on to... I'll bring in... we'll have a look. I think we'll talk about pyrotechnics because we haven't covered that really yet. And I'll maybe hand over to you, Russell.
Sure. I was going to ask about firework control zones, if that's OK. Now, during the consultation, these changed name from no firework area to firework control zone. And David's already referred to a bit of public confusion about what this actually means. And before people can breathe a sigh of relief, especially pet owners, that the perception, perhaps the name suggests, there's no fireworks in this area. But in fact, they can be open to official displays and professional organisations. I suppose it's twofold. One is it perhaps a missed opportunity? Should there have been, in your view, no firework areas? And secondly, given the nuances of this, how important is it going to be to properly communicate it to people?
I think in terms of the last point, any changes, a public awareness, communication campaign with the right messages targeted at the right groups is essential, and there's people that have far greater expertise than I have in those areas, but when I've used them in a previous life, I've seen the benefits of getting that right, so I think that's absolutely right. Sorry, what was the first part of the question?
Whether it was a missed opportunity not to in fact have no firework zones.
I think that I keep going back to this. when the group were looking at it, it was the intent behind it, and getting that balance right between being able to enjoy fireworks and not suffer some of the abuse that can take place. So this is where, you know, I'm speaking beyond the group here. I'm speaking personally. I don't think it's a big issue in changing that name, because if you're going to have organised displays and that's communicated properly, then people can, you know, look after their pets, etc., and it is safe, much safer to enjoy an organised display. So I think, again, it's people taking the intent, understanding it and trying to get the balance right in the way that the framed the legislation from the recommendations.
Yeah, that makes sense. Thank you.
Do you want to just pick up on pyrotechnics and that?
Yeah, it was some Scottish Police Federation evidence about this in the written submission. You talked about the need. Let me just find this, sorry. I think you've suggested that what's been proposed has been watered down. What would you like to see reinstated?
Yeah, so initially, what went out for public consultation was an offence to have a pyrotechnic in a public place, and that's what got the support there. But I believe there was, after the consultation, government came back and we feel it has been watered down to an extent in terms of it's in certain specific circumstances. And those circumstances are going to sporting events or music events or processions and parades. But that holds two problems for us. First of all, it doesn't cover all eventualities. And secondly, it opens up, by doing so, a grounds for defence that we fear would make it almost unworkable. And particularly in relation to sporting events, and especially football, the last thing in the world anybody needs in this country is legislation that is not good legislation when it comes to football. So we want the simplicity of the public space makes sense. We have sympathy and understand the perspective as to, so of course, it needs to be proportionate. And we understand the thinking behind the unintended consequences of deterring people like campers and sailors from having flares. But I mean, that's, we think, over-exaggerated, because A, a lot of campers don't have flares, and B, why on earth would they have one in the middle of a city centre? So it has to be about the circumstances, the context, and therefore the appropriate application of those powers. And I think just trying to legislate it out causes more problems and it risks spoiling good legislation for a problem that doesn't actually exist.
Okay. And I suppose, Alistair, picking up on that particular point, is it probably better to revisit that and have an absolute exemption unless you've got reasonable grounds to possess these items?
I don't feel competent to answer that, because it was not within, looking at this particular aspect of the consultation, was not within the remit of the fireworks group. So we didn't look at it from that perspective. Apologies.
Right, that's, I guess, one for us to take forward. OK, thank you.
OK, Jamie, do you want to finally come in?
No. Yeah, I just picking up on that point, the shift seems to be, or perhaps the problematic area, is this move from possession of something in the vicinity of a designated venue to prohibiting the possession of a pyrotechnic whilst travelling to the immediate vicinity of a designated venue or a public procession or public assembly. Now, public processions and assemblies happen in the street, in public places, you know, George Square, Prince's Street. Travelling to or from that, I mean, it's so vague. I think this is part of the problem, as anyone could reasonably say they were not travelling to that venue or not travelling to that procession, and therefore that would be an immediate defence, whether the possession of the item itself is not illegal, but travelling, the perception of travelling to an event is illegal. So I guess it's that vagueness that you're trying to avoid.
It's exactly that. And coupled to the problem it's trying to address not really being a problem, and certainly no evidence of that, it actually risks disproportionately undermining the legislation to the point that it makes it unworkable. And that's the our concern here with that, is keeping it as public space and having the reasonable excuse clauses in place, give people the protection that they're not going to... Your camper, anyone who's got a flare on a Inverkip marina, is not going to be getting charged under this offence. They're not going to be... There'll be no action taken about that. It's entirely reasonable, the context of it. Mm-hmm. Just as campers, who currently have axes and knives, we don't have any interaction with people. It's the context that matters, mm-hmm. to achieve the outcome. So, I guess just as trying to fix a problem that we don't think exists, yeah. and causes problems thereafter.
These are probably questions for the minister, to be honest. But I get the impression the problem they're trying to fix is people chucking flares at football games or certain religious processions where there have been problems.
So there currently is legislation for dealing with flares and pyrotechnics in football grounds. The problem, of course, is that there's two issues. First of all, there's the muling, if you like, where we know that some younger fans are encouraged to take pyrotechnics in for others as a kind of rite of passage. And we're needing these types of interventions and tools. So, looking at further upstream, if you like. So rather than dealing somebody at the gate of a stadium, which is where we currently are at, we need to have it a further away so we can deal with people earlier on if we have intelligence. And again, that's happened in the past. So the legislation goes the right way in terms of these designations. But where it does cause problems is that if you do intercept somebody, let's say outside their house, because you've intelligence that they're coming with a whole lot of pyrotechnics to a football ground, all they need to say is, I'm not going to a football ground. Mm-hmm. And that's the problem. And even right down at an officer's perspective as to, can I search this person? We're in doubt at that point straight away.
Right.
Much simpler just to have a much more general power.
That's helpful feedback. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I think we'll just have to wind things up, but I'm just wanting to bring you in if you've got any final comments, because I think it's an important subject to cover, Stuart.
Yeah, I think just as I said at the outset, the service fully support this move forward with this legislation. It will undoubtedly be, another tool in the toolbox, another step change to changing the culture associated with the use of fireworks, and along with all the really good work that happens every year in terms of preventative and community safety engagement, it will certainly make communities safer. But really importantly to me, it will make my firefighters and my colleagues in the emergency services much safer as well. Unfortunately, we do have incidents every year. We have house fires on November the 5th because fireworks have been misused, put through letterbox, stuff like that. I would like to be able to stop that from happening along with my colleagues.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you all for joining us today. I think that's been a really useful session. We've covered a lot. So we will now have a short break just to allow witnesses to change over. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome back, everybody. Our next item of business is our second evidence session on the Fireworks and Pyrotechnics Articles Scotland Bill. And I'm very pleased to welcome to today's meeting Rob Holland, Acting Director of the National Autistic Society of Scotland, Lorraine Gillies, Chief Executive of the Scottish Community Safety Network, and Julie Mendes-Ferreira, Head of Education, Policy and Research of the Scottish Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. So welcome to you all. We very much appreciate the time that you've taken to join us this morning. So I intend to allow about an hour to an hour and 15 minutes for questions and answers. So if I may, we'll just move directly to questions, and I'll open up with a very general initial question, and I'll maybe come, I'll just work my way around the room. I'll start with Gillie and then Lorraine and then Rob. So it's really just to ask you to outline a bit of your own experience and involvement in issues around fireworks and pyrotechnic articles, and whether from your kind of perspective you feel that the legislation that's being proposed and the provisions of the bill are the right step at the right time, if you like. So I'll start with you, Gillie.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you for inviting the Scottish SPCA today. Certainly the Scottish SPCA feels that this is heading in the right direction. Mm-hmm. We obviously have our animal helpline open every day of the year. We do receive concerns from members of the public, more so looking for advice to help the well-being of their animal. We have a number of animal rescue and rehoming centres where we actually see the direct impact of fireworks and visually see the impact it's having, particularly on the dogs in our care, I would say. We do give a lot of advice throughout the year, but having is quite hard at the moment. The challenges for a lot of people is the unpredictability of fireworks, so they can't put the preventative measures in place that they would like to when you have fireworks going off quite randomly, and also when these fireworks go off near places such as our rescue and rehoming centres. So we feel that this bill is certainly covering a lot of the concerns that we have when it comes to the use of fireworks. Mm. So we very much welcome it at present.
Okay, thank you very much. Lorraine, I'll just come to you.
Thank you, and thank you again for letting us come along. So we are a member organisation. Our members are typically large organisations that are working in the field of community safety, and we've been doing quite a lot of discussions and consultations with our member organisations on this. We were part of the initial consultation. We supported the Scottish Government when the initial consultation was happening back in the day when you could speak to actual people in community centres. And then I was on the Fireworks Review Group with Gillie and a bunch of others. We support the Community Wardens Network, and we also support the Antisocial Behaviour Officers Forum. So we have got quite a lot of sort of links into organisations that are working on the front line around antisocial behaviour and fireworks. I think in terms of the measures in the bill, I think that I'm confident that we've managed to achieve the best we can within the framework that we're operating in. I was very conscious of the amount of input into the exercise, the consultation, and I think we had an awful lot of interest from members of the public, and I think that was really interesting. I think the measures are proportionate. I think that they will keep people safer, and that's the primary issue for my organisation. I do think, though, that the bigger picture around antisocial behaviour is something that we really need to think about separately. For me, as a mum of a child whose birthday is around bonfire night, it was tradition in our family to have some fireworks. And it wasn't until that we got into the whole thick of it, you know, that I just realised the extent of the antisocial behaviour, you know, and the real awful situations that people are living in. And so whilst the measures that we have in the Fireworks and Pyrotechnics Bill, I think, are entirely appropriate, I do think that we have some work to do around understanding antisocial behaviour and what approaches and mechanisms we might have to do something differently there. Mm-hmm. So, thank you.
Thanks, Lorraine. Rob?
Yes, and thank you for inviting us to give evidence. 1 in 100 children and adults in Scotland are autistic, and I think just for the purpose of this discussion, I'll talk a little bit about autism and the impact that, that fireworks might have on people. Autism itself is a spectrum, and that is to say that each and everyone's strengths and challenges vary quite considerably, and some of those people need round-the-clock care and support, while others live fully independent lives with very little in the way of support, and it's more about a bit of understanding. Autism itself is a widely understood term by the general public, but there's a lot of myths and assumptions and mistruths about what is autism is and the impact that it has on people. So people often think about the challenges around social communication and social interaction, particularly with non-autistic people, but perhaps think less so about the sensory sensitivities that some, not all autistic people face. So that might be a heightened sense when it comes to touch, taste, sound, light, for example. And fireworks, by their very nature, are a sensory experience, quite an extreme sensory experience in some ways. And that might be quite joyful for some autistic people, but might be very distressing for others. And so we routinely hear from families in the lead up to large cultural events or religious events that are celebrated with fireworks, the stress and the distress that that those can cause, and it's not necessarily just an unpleasant experience. It can be extremely distressing. So we hear from autistic people and families who they simply can't go out the house when it's bonfire night, for example. Or they have to do lots of things to kind of mitigate the experience, so turning the TV up loud or even leaving that area. And in some extreme cases, that distress can lead to what are often termed shutdowns or meltdowns, when that person reacts involuntarily, perhaps physically, perhaps verbally, and perhaps they're a risk to themselves or those around them. So. And then just to echo a point which Lorraine made as well, the unpredictability around fireworks is a hazard in and of itself. So while a lot of families, for example, will go out of their way to create a very structured routine-based day for their child, which, you know, adds a great deal of comfort, if that is interrupted by an unpredictable event, such as a firework going off in a place where it shouldn't be going off, and unbeknownst to them, then that can be incredibly distressing as well. So from our point of view, we welcome the moves to bring further regulation to this and limit their use, particularly in unpredictable ways.
Thanks very much. That's really helpful. If I can just come back with a couple of follow-up questions, I'll maybe come to you, Lorraine. And one of the things, just touching on the issue around antisocial behaviour that we're very, very aware of, I'm aware that there is evidence around the sort of use and the unintended consequences, or perhaps intended consequences, of the sort of misuse of fireworks. And I know from some of the information that we've been given that there is evidence to suggest that most fireworks injuries are actually take place end up at private events. They often involve young people. They often involve young males. And they seem to be the sort of group that are most at risk. In that regard, then, if we're looking at how the bill responds to issues around antisocial behaviour, and I think the other issue within that is around injuries, a lot of them are to heads, hands, that type of injury, some of which can be very serious. Do you feel the provisions of the bill would adequately support our efforts to tackle antisocial behaviour, particularly from the perspective of reducing injuries?
I think it helps. I don't think it's the complete answer. Mm-hmm. I was staggered When we were out, I was in, for example, in Pollock Shields one miserable night in Glasgow, talking to 65 people from the community who had come out to talk to us about fireworks. Mm-hmm. And I readily admit, you know, I didn't understand the, you know, the depth of it. And they were telling us really horrific stories of almost rite of passage stuff happening with young people. Mm-hmm. You know, how long can you hold a lit firework in your hand? You know, stuff like that. And I was astonished by it and thought, oh my God, what do we do here? So I think that we have to have the measures that we have in this bill. I think that that's a very good starting point. We need to have something to start with and something to give us some baseline information on. I don't think it's the whole story. I think that I've already said, and I'm happy to go, you know, further and say that we really do need to think differently about antisocial behaviour. My view is that when we know so much about trauma and ACEs and deprivation and hopelessness and poverty and the behaviours that are responsive to all of that, you know, I think it's no surprise to us that our young people do behave antisocially. Mm-hmm. And it's not just the young people. I think it's just worth making that point. I don't want to go too far into the realms of antisocial behaviour because we're here to talk about fireworks, but my organisation has completed some significant pieces of research just trying to understand what is happening in Scotland around antisocial behaviour, who is behaving antisocially, what is antisocial behaviour, and it's not what you think. Mm-hmm. I was listening before I came in to Stuart talking about the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service seeing an increase in antisocial behaviour, and I think that's reflected across the piece. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Before COVID, we had evidence to say that was reducing. But I think COVID has, without a doubt, you know, been a part to play in it. Mm. And you know, fireworks, like I say, are part of the culture in some communities. It's part of what you do. You know, it's the game that you play. And we really need to think about how we support those communities and individuals in those communities to choose different paths. Mm-hmm. So restricting the use of fireworks, restricting the access is part of it. But I think we really need to think long and hard about what additional supports we can put in. Mm-hmm.
Thanks for that. Coming to yourself, Julie, and staying on the theme of antisocial behaviour, mm-hmm. obviously from your perspective, I know, and we touched on this earlier on, was around opportunities for pet owners to perhaps prepare for bonfire night. But obviously we're aware that fireworks can be used randomly, so you can't always do that. Do you think there is scope, and this is maybe slightly stepping outside the provisions of the bill, but is there scope and benefit to maybe encouraging owners to seek maybe professional help in terms of managing their pets, perhaps classic FM, sedatives, that type of thing? But is there a bit of work that could be done around that?
Yeah, so we certainly, all the advice that we put out is exactly that advice. Speak to your local vet. We know that the number of, sort of calming medications and everything that are prescribed, it goes in peaks and troughs and align with obviously when fireworks are going off. We know, we've done our own research with the effects of music, and it's something that we use in our own centres. Mm-hmm. The biggest sort of things that we see through the helpline, it's nothing, not necessarily to do with the organised events that happen, your New Year's fireworks and so on. It's these ones in local communities where maybe there's also not been that communication between people who live in that communities, that they've given other people that awareness that they are planning on having fireworks. And something, and I know I've said this before to do with the bill, it's good having all these different measures, but the communication piece is going to be crucial for this to be effective. You've got the enforcement side as well, but that public messaging so that people actually understand the expectations. We will always, together with other organisations, British Veterinary Association, we all give very similar messaging. We always regroup and make sure that we're not confusing the public with the animal welfare messaging that we are providing. And that is really important because the simpler that you can make it for everybody, then obviously that's easier for people to get the assistance they require. Training animals, I know that's been mentioned before. You can train animals in lots of different ways. Some are more trainable than others. I know there's been a lot of reference about training your dogs. It's your responsibility to train your dogs. Dogs will react in different ways. The ones that are in our centres, we don't have that history. When they come into it, obviously when they've come into the Scottish SPCA's care, they're getting rehabilitated. And when you have fireworks going off, that can actually put their rehabilitation process backwards. Mm-hmm. And we can do lots of measures. We cover the windows, we put thunder shirts on the dogs, for example. These are a bit like when you swaddle a baby. You know, it helps keep them hopefully feel a bit more secure. But when we come in the next day, in some of our sites, we have discarded sort of firework cartridges and debris in our car parks. And you go to the kennel areas in particular, and the dogs have defecated, etc., more than they normally would. They've destroyed their bedding. They don't want to come out. When you've opened the hatch for them to come out in the outdoor run, they don't want to come out. And then the staff are having to go back and start doing that rehabilitation process. And that's where that, when you've had the community side of things and the community experience where maybe it's been a bit more off guard, or the fireworks have gone on for longer than you would anticipate during that time of year, that's where it becomes a big issue for us. And I know we spoke more about domestic, but it's also livestock, it's wildlife. A wild animal doesn't know which way to run, mm-hmm. away or to fireworks. Livestock are the same. We give advice to those who are responsible for livestock. Obviously, if you have the opportunity, bring your animals closer to your house, but it depends where your land is. That's not always an opportunity. And we know from those who have horses, again, it can be quite challenging. Yes, you can stable them. Is that the best thing? Is the animal actually going to get more distressed because they've not got that room to move away? If they're in a field, is there a risk that they could actually break through fencing and then go onto a road, cause a road traffic accident? So there's all these things, and I think we have that responsibility, you know, of having that good communication so that people can prepare. Training, yes, can be one aspect, but that doesn't work for all species. So,
okay, that's very, very, very interesting. Covered a lot there. I'm going to hand over to Russell, and then I'll bring in Katie just to ask some questions about licensing.
Yeah, I mean, I won't jump ahead. There are issues I'd like to come back to about licensing, control zones, and so on. But in general terms, we've heard from the police, from the Scottish Fire and Rescue, and indeed during our visit to Blackburn on Monday, that this seems to be a problem that's got worse over the years, over recent years. And what seems to be perhaps lacking, though, is any sort of measurement of that. We've heard of incidents and firefighters being attacked and police officers being attacked and issues of that nature. But I suppose it's a question for Lorraine. Do you have anything that does quantify the prevalence of firework use over the course of a year?
No, we don't. What we do know is it's definitely not a one-size-fits-all situation. So we do hear from some authority areas that say this is a big issue for them, and some don't consider it to be such a big issue. But I don't have anything in the way of a collective amount of data that would tell the right story. So there is, you know, we've heard this morning about attacks on emergency services. There's good A&E data, but that's not, you know, complete enough to be able to give us a sense of what the issue is.
From the perspective of the SSPCA, I guess you may not have measured it in any way, but you know it to be the case. You've experienced a significant rise over the years.
I would say over the last couple of years, our call rates have been pretty stable when it comes, and it's mainly advice calls. If you see any, whether it's linked to antisocial behaviour or what have you, physical attacks on animals, that's quite few and far between, I am pleased to say. So generally it's more advice where people are witnessing that animals are in distress in a field, or for, particularly for their own animals. But we just see the peaks, but you're talking about 12 to 15 advice calls around the bonfire night period, which you wouldn't normally get maybe at other times of the year, specifically to fireworks.
But presumably it used to always be around bonfire night, and now there's other dates in the calendar where you're getting distressed animals. Is that
The date range is broader now. So traditionally you would see, you'd expect preempt in the helpline, bonfire night's going to be busy, we're going to get lots of calls with people looking for advice. That window has expanded because of when fireworks are available for purchase, and obviously when people choose to use them. So you do see that, and that's where it makes it much harder for people to prepare, because it then becomes more unpredictable because the window's longer.
Yeah. Thank you. Okay.
Okay, thanks very much. Katie, would you like to come in, and then we'll move on to control zones, and I'll bring in Rona Mackay.
Thank you very much. The intention of the licensing scheme is to reduce the inconsiderate use and misuse of fireworks. Have you had the opportunity to look at the proposed licensing scheme, and do you think that, as presented, it's likely to achieve its outcome? And what concerns do you have that individuals who are intent on misusing fireworks will just ignore the scheme and carry on? Maybe if Lorraine would like to come in on that first.
I'm just looking back for reference to what we gave in terms of the evidence. I mean, I think that there are some opportunities with the licensing scheme. I think you're exactly right, you know, that we know through history that there will be individuals who just don't want to be licensed or controlled in any shape or form. That, again, is back to my early discussion about culture and antisocial behaviour, and there are people that will behave in that way. Because that's what they know, that's what they do. I think the licensing system is a start. I think that it's been a really positive thing that we can introduce as a set of measures. I think there's something about safety courses that we might want to think about differently. I think these things we can do. I think we have to be very careful about digital access and all that sort of stuff. But I definitely think that there's something we can do in communities with community groups. Interestingly, Gillie and I were talking before we came in about the power of communities and the power of individuals to be able to take forward some of the mechanisms that are in here. And we discussed that's very difficult to make happen, because very often it's about individuals taking responsibility and stepping forward. I think that's the kind of situation that it is. And I think that's no different to any situation that we recognise. You know, there will be people that comply, there will be people that don't comply. But to have the measures that we're suggesting is a start and is good.
Thank you. Gillie, I don't know if you'd like to come in on that.
Yeah, so I think, definitely the licensing is a good start. I know there's mention of an online training course. Obviously, education's part of my remit as well, and we have to recognise that barrier to technology, that people have different learning styles, that you would probably need to invest more in those targeted approaches within communities and learning from those communities and how best to action that. We do run a multi-agency schools campaign. We've run it now for 2 years and we'll be running it again this year. And again, it brings back to that point of having that consistent messaging. So part of that group is Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, it's Police Scotland, Lorraine and others, to make sure that communication to young people, we're all saying the same things. Mm-hmm. So it's not just about animal welfare. It's covering the human side. It's covering even like the debris that's left, how to be responsible, how to be safe, don't bow to peer pressure, all those types of things. So I think we've learned a lot running that for the last 2 years. And that'll be something we will continue to do. But certainly the learning course that accompanies the licensing shouldn't be a tick box exercise. It needs to have clear outcomes, and it needs to have the adaptations in place to meet different people's needs and meet that diversity that we have in our population.
Mm-hmm. Rob?
Yeah, I mean, just to build on what's been said, we're supportive of the proposals as set out in terms of licensing, mm-hmm. but what goes alongside that, I think, is equally important here. And for us, it's going back to that point I made earlier about the fact is that the vast majority of people just don't know about the impact that fireworks and particularly, unauthorised use of fireworks has on autistic people. So it's that broader message about how do we communicate that so that people understand the impact, and that we would hope they would make different decisions in terms of training, whether it be online, whether it be offline. I think our experience is that the most powerful training is training delivered by autistic people themselves, talking about their experiences and the personal impact that it's had on them or families, talking about the impact on them as families and their children. That is much more powerful than a tick box or a module or written examples.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. I think we'll move on now to control zones. I'm just keeping track of the themes that we're looking to cover. And I'll bring in Rona Mackay, and then I'll come back to you, Russell. Rona?
Thank you. Thanks, convener. Good morning, panel. Yes, can I ask your opinion on the firework control zones that are being proposed and how effective you think these could be in reducing for vulnerable people. And I'd also like to ask the question of if you think there's a danger of displacement, i.e. In a community where which has a control zone in it, would the antisocial behaviour just move to another area? And perhaps Lorraine would want to ask. I'll come to you first, Lorraine, and then Rob, and then Gillian.
I suspect that is a possibility. Need to be very clear about that. I think the establishment of local control zones, though, is potentially a useful tool, a useful mechanism. I think what's going to be critical, though, is the involvement of local communities in those local control zones and achieving their support to make this work. And what I've learned is that there are people in communities that really want to make a difference, that really don't want this to happen in their communities, and identifying those people and engaging them in the process is absolutely critical. Yes, we do know, you know, that young people or older people or anyone who has a need or a want to cause a disturbance will manage to do that. You can start a fight in an empty house if you want to do that. So that will happen. I think that's probably, you know, going to happen. But I think knowing that at this point and being aware of that and raising that as a clear unintended consequence is something that we will have to be very careful about and keep a close eye on. We work with 32 community safety partnership leads and elected members across Scotland, and we are able to have those discussions. We meet with them on a monthly basis, and fireworks is a hot topic, always is a hot topic, no matter what time of year. So we do have to keep an eye on it, there's no question.
Thank you. Thanks, Lorraine. Rob, is there any kind of planning that you can do in any way for you know, the days in November and other days when you know there's going to be a lot of fireworks? And do you think the control zones will have an effect?
Well, on control zones, we welcome those proposals. I think it will provide some reassurance to families and autistic individuals. Certainly, I think the key is, as Lorraine said, it's about engaging people locally in that discussion and engaging with autistic people, families and organisations representing them so that their views are fully listened to. In terms of your first question around how can families potentially prepare for, you know, organised firework displays? We have produced some guidance on that for families, which is something that they've been calling for some time, and so, you know, that guidance has a range of things for people to consider. So whether that is for those that actually want to attend a fireworks display, but want to take various precautions in doing so. There are things that can be done that work for some people, not everyone. So, for example, ear defenders for those that are particularly sensitive to noise. We encourage and families to plan well in advance and have an idea of what's going to happen, when it's going to happen, what it's going to look like, that kind of thing, so that there are no surprises for that individual or that child. And some of this is about the organisers as well. What steps can they take to make a fireworks display as inclusive as possible? So providing lots of information up front, perhaps having a quiet place that you can retreat to if necessary. So there are some things that can be done, and of course some autistic people and families enjoy fireworks displays, and so there are steps that they can do to make it more comfortable. But the reality is, all those steps that you can take and all those things that you can prepare, it's still not going to work for everyone. So I think the concepts of a control zone where they are much more limited will be hugely comforting for a lot of families.
Thank you. Thanks, Rob. Gillian.
Yeah, so again,
certainly very supportive of the control zones. It gives us that opportunity to help safeguard the welfare of the animals in our care. For instance, again, it comes back to the unpredictability. If we know fireworks are due to go and we know there's a particular animal in our care that is extremely sensitive, we have the opportunity then to move them to another location within the centres or even move between centres. Trying to do that instantaneously can be hard. We have obviously biosecurity measures and things depending on what's wrong with the animals as well that we have to take into consideration. It's not as easy as just taking an animal out of a kennel and taking it home with somebody because it's fearful of the fireworks. You know, there's lots of planning and contingencies that we need to put in place. I think the firework control zones will be hugely beneficial, and likewise doesn't always work for everyone, the measures that are in place. Animals are just as individual as people are, but I think anything that we can do to put in place those preventative measures are going to have a positive impact and allowing that opportunity for people to plan ahead.
Thanks, Jillie. Can I ask you, in particular, I mean, animals don't enjoy fireworks. I think that's a given. Would you have preferred to have seen an outright ban on fireworks from your organisation's point of view? Would that have been preferable?
It's interesting, I did sit on the review group and we spent, and Lorraine will say this, we spent a lot of time talking about should there be a ban and the impact that has. My concern at the moment is the unintended consequences of that. Would it just drive traffic? We've seen it with the puppy trade, which some of you have engaged with us as an organisation. We've seen tightening up on online sales. Does that drive to other issues? And we're seeing lots of issues in that space. And I see that particularly when you've got something where you have got that online sales network, which is quite hard to control. I would be concerned at this stage, unless that research has happened, to look at the unintended consequences about pushing for a full-time ban just now.
Thank you. That's interesting. Thank you, Convener.
OK, thanks very much. I'll hand over to Russell.
Yeah, the consultation shows overwhelming support for what was described as no firework zones, with 83% backing that. Now, these changed their name at some point from no firework zones to firework control areas, I think. Now, in the SSPCA's evidence, you suggest that it should revert back to that original description, that there should be areas where there are just no fireworks. There shouldn't be the allowance for professional displays to come into these areas. Is that something that you can expand on? And is that something that Rob's organisation would also agree with?
So we have got some particular centres. I'll give example of our Cadonald Centre in Glasgow, which is our largest site. And we have a lot of animals in there. We have a lot of animals who have been through court cases, and well, not themselves, but are subject to court cases. That is a zone that, despite the staff's efforts and despite going out, engaging with communities, trying to do that communication piece, we can't seem to get past that point where it's not having a negative effect on the animals in our care due to the size of the site. So that, for example, would be one that we feel, you know, that should be one that comes under these firework control zones. There will be other areas as well, not necessarily relating to animals, but might relating to, and Rob might expand on that. I know that we've mentioned to do with some care homes or those where there's sites of people who have struggled with PTSD and things like that. And that certainly would be up for those organisations to say that. But it's a matter of, that is the concern about displacement. If it's not in that zone, because that's a no zone, where do those people go? The links with the antisocial behaviour. But certainly, for our perspective, there would be some of our sites that we would see, you know, that should be an all year round thing.
Yeah.
Yes, we would support that. I mean, as you know, hopefully I've articulated, the impact of fireworks can be extremely distressing. So, you know, if a family was to be able to make a decision to live in an area which was, you know, there would be no fireworks guarantee, it, you know, as far as possible, then I imagine some families would take, you know, the initiative to live in that area. I think without a doubt. I think, you know, there may be the phrase firework control zone may lead people to the assumption that there is not going to be any fireworks there, and as my understanding that there still might be fireworks within firework control zone. So I think that could create some confusion there, which could in turn lead to, you know, whenever those fireworks are used, then that's the added unpredictability there for that family to deal with.
Yeah, thank you. It does seem to be, you know, there's the absolute ban, which is impractical and wouldn't work, and then there's the free-for-all, which isn't quite where we're at just now, and this is almost the worst of both, in that it doesn't solve the problem. But I don't know what the answer is, so thank you. If you get any thoughts on that, please enlighten us.
I think it's heading in the right direction. It's very hard when there's a lot of measures. There was measures that introduced, obviously, last year, which I don't think we've probably seen the true effects of that yet. You add these on top. And I think, I keep going back to it, it's the partnerships, it's the communication, you know, and working together to solve quite a challenging issue which has a lot of different viewpoints. And I think I learned a lot through the fireworks review group, certainly from the NHS and others who were part of that group, and seen different sides. So I think this is certainly a really good place that we've got to at the moment with what's within control. I know that we've mentioned things about packaging and decibels and things like that as well, but that comes back to the sale and the products and so on, which not necessarily within this scope. So certainly I think it's heading in the right direction, and we need to also look at how we track the impact of these different measures.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. OK, thanks very much. I'll bring in Jamie, and then I'll come to Fulton to pick up on restrictions on use and supply. So, Jamie.
Thank you. And I hope, Fulton, I'm not taking your next question, because I have no idea what you're going to ask, but I'll try not do that again. But I guess maybe a similar line of question to the last panel, and that's that, you know, the majority of people use fireworks safely, the majority of people enjoy their use, and the majority of people do not purchase or use them with the intent of causing violence or harm to others, or indeed engage in antisocial behaviour. So there could be an argument that we are restricting the sale, purchase and use of something because of the actions of a minority in society who don't respect the rules of normal social behaviour or indeed the law. I just wondered what you would say to those people, and particularly we've had evidence from people who actually sell fireworks, small businesses, normally family run, normally quite traditional, who say that actually that's the best place to be selling fireworks, is in that controlled place where they know who their customers are, they can see them, they can check for licences if such a scheme is in place, and they can check for people's age and identities and so on and make individual personalised decisions. Whereas if they simply go bust because we've shut down their business or restricted it to the point of making it inconceivably commercially viable, then that will fuel that black market that none of us want to see. I just wondered if anyone had a view on that. Perhaps Lorraine first, and then Gillian and others.
I am acutely aware of the consequences that this will have on people who work in the fireworks industry, and they have my absolute sympathy. This is not about banging people on the head and restricting their lifestyles. But I was one of those people who liked fireworks, and I still quite like fireworks. But having been involved in this piece of work for a good few years now, I have been struck by the amount of damage and chaos that fireworks can cause. We've had the debate about legal fireworks, illegal fireworks, all of that. Even with the best will in the world, families using fireworks, there are some real safety issues. These are very dangerous things in the hands often of small children and young children. Fireworks being put through letterboxes, fireworks being put into exhausts of cars, fireworks being lobbed across the street at people. There's no doubt in my mind that these are dangerous things, and we need to do more to keep people safe from the unintended consequences of them. And that will have economic impacts on people who work in the industry, and they have my absolute sympathy about that. But the primary purpose of the Scottish Community Safety Network is safety, keeping communities safe. And we 100% are behind the work of the Fireworks Review Group and the measures that are put in here, because the consequences of damage from fireworks are life-limiting, in fact, fatal. they're not. I have changed my view. I won't buy them now. It just won't happen. I'm just completely changed on it.
Mm-hmm. So. That's interesting. If for example, the point of a license is that you had to go through some hoops, whether it's training or an online course, as is the case with the person of other things. I mean, there's no online course for going out and buying kitchen knives, but they're hugely dangerous. There's no online course for buying alcohol, but it's a problem in society which fuels antisocial behaviour. I just wondered why that in itself would not be enough, why we'd have to go to the point of effectively closing down industry to tackle the problem.
I don't think that we are talking about closing down an industry. I think what we're trying to make sure happens is that people are able to access these things should they want to, safely. What I also was struck in the whole consultation is the number of community groups that were coming saying we the fireworks are brilliant for our community. Do you know, we all get together, we all enjoy it, we fundraise throughout the year. It's fundamental for our community. It's part of who we are. Please don't tell me you're going to stop that. There is absolutely no interest in stopping that, and nor should we, nor could we. It is primarily about safe use of fireworks. And it's not at all about stopping point blank the use of fireworks, because that would not be appropriate. I've said clearly that that's not something I'll be doing. I won't be buying fireworks for personal use again, but I may well go to a local community event because there's a huge amount of value in that.
Mm-hmm. Good, thank you.
I'll probably certainly echo what Lorraine's saying. I think the organised events where you've got the professionals there, they've set everything up. Communities have all the right safety measures in place. It's the private use that causes the concerns and the issues. It only takes one firework to actually affect quite a large number of people. So I can understand concerns about, it's going to affect livelihoods and so on for those who are in the industry. But having that responsibility of the people who want to do it right are coming in, they're asking the right questions, they're getting the licence, they're doing everything that they should be doing and having those conversations. It's the ones that, and we've spoken about antisocial behaviour, the ones who, no matter what you put in place, are they going to follow it, are they not? It links back to that private use aspect, and that's what causes the biggest challenge. So you have to do something to tighten that up so that you can not have that impact that we see, whether it's animals, whether it's humans, from even just one firework and the distress that calls. And if it's going to help save a child not losing their hand, a dog from running on the road, things like that, then we have to take that into account, because that's also part of the community that are voicing their opinions on this.
Thank you. And a dog running on the road is the most terrifying moment of your life. I can vouch for that. It's horrific. Rob, I just wondered if you had any comments on my points.
I think most of the points have been made, really. I mean, just to echo a couple of them, we're certainly not calling for, organised fireworks events to be banned, because we recognise the significance and the cultural and religious celebratory significance that those play. And, many autistic people enjoy those experiences and are part of those. But it's the that kind of unpredictable use of fireworks, which we are particularly concerned about. And as I said earlier, a lot of individuals or families will go out of their way to create a safe, structured day. And when that is interrupted by that type of thing, it can be hugely distressing if a child is on their way back from school with their family and, a firework is let off. Then that can be quite a traumatic experience, which then becomes connected to their journey to or from school, for example. So we completely take the point that fireworks play an important cultural role in society, and we're not calling for an outright ban, but it's more the kind of haphazard, unplanned, antisocial use of fireworks, which we're particularly concerned about. So that's our reasoning in terms of supporting this.
Thank you. That's also very helpful. And, of course, it does get dark quite early in winter, so mm-hmm. you're more likely to see them at the sort of time of day that you talk mm-hmm. about. So that's interesting. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Fulton McGregor just to pick up on issues around restrictions on use and supply. Over to you, Fulton.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. You may have heard in the last panel session there some of the questions around this, because there was quite a few of us had questions, and it's around the specific restrictions that are proposed in the bill. And that's around the limit of the days and times when fireworks can be sold and used. So what do you think of these? I suppose quite a general question. What do you think of these, and do you have any concerns about the legislation specifying certain days? Happy to take in any order.
Lorraine, do you want to come in on that?
So I think what will be helpful is enabling better deployment of resources, particularly emergency services. I think that has got to be, you know, one of the number one benefits of the restrictions of use times. I don't think we can ever get it completely right. I think the attempt at putting dates and times together is an attempt at just trying to bring some order to what can be quite chaotic. We've already talked about fireworks can go off at any time of the day, night, week, year, month. You know, we've moved into sort of constant, you know, firework alert mode, particularly for animals and for disabled people. So my view is that this will help in resource planning, and it will help with at least trying to identify and deploy resources at the right time in the right places.
Fulton, do you want to pick up on that, or?
Yeah, I think that is one of the main key benefits, and you know, I fully understand why certain days have been put in that will allow not only emergency services to prepare, but also it will allow, as we heard quite articulately in the last panel, it will allow owners, for example, of pets to prepare, maybe to not be in the area or to you know, seek alternatives, medication and such like, I think was mentioned. So I do understand that. The worry that I do have, and I know that other members do share, is that, you know, by specifying dates, you actually go into an arena of you've not specified other dates, such as other religious festivals and other events that may be important to people. So I think that, you know, that is the concern that I have. And what I want to do with this legislation is make sure that if there's any way we can improve that, or make sure that it's not open to some sort of challenge in the future, then, you know, that's our job. But I'm wondering, Rob, have you got any thoughts on the specified dates? How do you think that impacts on, you know, people that you'd be working with?
Yeah, I think, as I touched upon earlier, a lot of autistic people and families, you know, they need to plan and prepare for when there are going to be fireworks, so that whether that is whether, you know, they are not in the area, so it's not an issue, or whether they're taking kind of mitigating it by you know, making sure that they've got ear defenders on hand, or turning the TV up, or you know, parents are kind of preparing and talking to their children about what's going to happen. So if you know, fireworks, the use of them is limited to specific times of the year, that does allow families you know, that opportunity to plan. So that can that can only be a good thing.
Okay, thanks. Convener, I'm actually quite happy to leave it there. I think that's been two really good answers, and it's good to have that on record about these particular restrictions.
Okay, thanks very much. If I may, before we move on, I'd just like to quickly pick up on an issue that we spoke about earlier on, and it was related to your questions, Jamie, about the impact on the fireworks industry, and in particular, we spoke about the fact that quite a lot of fireworks are sold by small local businesses, and there has been some commentary around the potential perhaps for government compensation for perhaps businesses that are maybe will lose out in terms of their income as a result of the legislation. I'm just interested in whether panel members have got any, maybe Lorraine yourself, if you've got any thoughts on the prospect of a compensation scheme and whether or not that would be something that you'd be interested in seeing.
I actually am not convinced either way. I think that if a compensation scheme was to be happening, it would depend on robust evidence of loss of earnings and loss of income. And I'm not entirely sure that that information would be readily available. I do recognise that nobody wants to see small businesses suffer. Nobody wants that to happen at all. And my caveat would be, if there is some possibility of being able to offer a compensation scheme based on actual income lost and evidence-based decisions, then I don't see why that would be wrong. But my concern is that this is quite a difficult area to be getting into, and it needs to be fair and equal, and those would be the kind of parameters for me.
OK, thanks. I don't know if either of the other panel members want to pick up on that at all, or if you're...
I would probably just say the same. Obviously, any compensation scheme, you know, you need the evidence there and the consistency on how it would work as well. And certainly if a business is going to lose out of this, then that certainly should be considered. So.
Rob, any points you want to make on
that? I don't
think
I'm very best well placed to comment on this. I mean, I think, you know, we would look at it from the other point of view, and what is the impact on autistic people and their lives and their livelihoods and their employment opportunities, education opportunities, and all the rest of this. And, you know, hopefully I've tried to articulate the impact this could have, particularly on young people. And if unauthorised use of fireworks does lead to difficulties at school, for example. We know that a lot of autistic young people struggle at school and don't get the support they need to succeed at school. Exclusions are high, employment rates are very, very low. And, you know, there are lots of different reasons for that. Fireworks is not the main reason for that, of course, but it is one example of the kind of difficulties of living in a society that's not designed for autistic people. And you know, there can be incidences which lead to trauma, which in turn, can have a huge impact on education attainment, employment prospects, and all the and all the rest of that. So while I'm not, you know, I don't want to comment specifically on compensation, you know, on the other side, there is, you know, an economic impact, I think, on the group that we're advocating on behalf of.
Thanks for that. I'd like to finish things off just looking a little bit at the issue around pyrotechnics. But before we do that, I'm going to bring in Colette Stevenson, who I know has got an interest in the issue of silent fireworks. So over to you, Colette.
Okay, thanks, convener, and good morning to the panel. I just wanted to ask, I know it's not within the bill and the remit of the bill, but what are your own views on silent fireworks? And why do you think it isn't actually featuring in the bill? And maybe would you like to see it featured in the bill?
Lorraine, could you want to pick that up?
Yeah, when we were out talking to people a couple of years ago, we were made aware of silent fireworks, and we did look at silent fireworks. There's much more use of silent fireworks in European countries like Italy. There is the kind of that's a thing. My own view is, why not? Do you know, that much of the problems around fireworks are the noise. That's established. But when you take that away, I'm not sure about silent fireworks being used in antisocially in the same sort of levels. I just don't have the evidence, and I don't have the information. We tried to find some evidence and information about that, but it just simply wasn't there. That's not particularly helpful, but...
I'll hand over to Julie and then maybe Rob.
So again, no, certainly silent fireworks again, it's the noise aspect is the biggest problem for animals. You can screen off windows, you know, you can close stable doors and so on, read the flashing side of things, but it's the noise that is the biggest concern. It's interesting, actually, because our Edinburgh site, there's a local group and they are looking at using silent fireworks and came up and asked for opinions and so on, which was really nice, actually. It showed that community communication. So certainly, again, yeah, why not have silent fireworks? There's growing evidence. I would say there's not... I think you need more evidence looking at the pros and cons of that side of things, but certainly you've seen more of it in European countries.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. Rob?
Yes, I mean, you know, our concerns stem from the sensitivities that some autistic people have to noise and loud noise, and, you know, fireworks make a loud noise. Mm-hmm. So if they were to be silent, that would undoubtedly work for some autistic people. So it would certainly make a difference, I think. Mm-hmm.
Happy with that, Colette?
Slightly quickly, convener, go back. I don't know if it was Gillie involved in the actual firework review group.
Yes.
And if so, was there any dialogue on that at all?
Yes, no, we did speak about silent fireworks and we were trying to find that evidence. And that was quite hard, and Lorraine will obviously say the same. I think we did spend quite a bit of time actually speaking about the use of silent fireworks. One of the things that ourselves have been speaking with BVA in particular is, you know, the packaging of fireworks. Can you change that so that if it is a loud firework, that it has something like a risk to animal welfare, you know, so that from a consumer point of view, they can actually make those decisions as well. So I think there's lots that could be done in that space, and certainly silent fireworks should be considered. I think we need to get more evidence as well on how those can be used effectively.
Okay, thanks for that.
Sorry,
Colette. I'm just going to finish off the session just... With some questions around pyrotechnics. So, for example, the sort of flare type thing that we see at football matches and other events, and really just to ask if you've got any particular comments to make on the provisions around pyrotechnics. We've heard this morning from the Scottish Police Federation a bit about issues of public possession, but it was really just to pose that question to you. So maybe start with Gillie and then Lorraine and Rob.
Yeah, so obviously these devices, again, obviously I'm speaking from an animal perspective, at some of these events you may have police dogs, service animals who are there to do a job. Their job's not going to get any easier if they've got things like that going off when they're there purely for crowd control and other things. So you've got a large volume of people having devices in that context. It makes no sense to have those there. So certainly any restrictions around there, we'd fully support.
Lorraine, do you want to come in at all?
I'm just looking through some of the papers just to remind me. I think that we deliberately didn't really make a comment on pyrotechnics because it's out with the kind of the range of the comments that we've been having with some of our CSPs. So if it's OK, I'm going to duck out of this question.
Of course, you're welcome to send anything in.
Yeah.
On that. That's absolutely no problem. Rob?
I don't have an awful lot to add on pyrotechnics. The comments that I've made on fireworks more broadly, I think, apply to pyrotechnics, you know, which can be equally distressing and can cause equal concern, I think, for autistic people and families. So.
Mm. Okay, thank you very much. You want to go? No? Okay. Okay, I think that brings us to a close. Thank you very much indeed for attending. I think we've picked up a lot of very helpful evidence this morning. So thank you, and we'll just have a short break to allow our witnesses to leave. Thank you. Thank you and welcome back, everyone. The next agenda item is consideration of the Prisons and Young Offenders Institutions Coronavirus Scotland Amendment Rules 2022, and I refer members to Paper 5. The committee has previously taken evidence on this negative instrument, and so I would like to invite any further views that members may have on it. So I can just... Yep, Jamie?
The only one is just the obvious one, and that is just to express concern that this is a negative instrument, which is an issue that's raised before, that the only way to deal with negative instruments are via annulling them in the chamber, rather than the role of the committee being to proactively pass them, which would be the case in the affirmative procedure. So I would just simply feedback to the government that in future such sweeping regulations, which we have taken a bit of evidence on, and not all of it's been positive at that, that these things should in future be dealt with, certainly no least at the end of this extension, could either be dealt with via other forms of legislation or via the affirmative procedure. And on that, it's worth noting that many members and those who that we spoke to during the evidence sessions did raise a number of quite valid concerns about the nature of some of the provisions, whilst understanding the reason for the extension. And I think all of us are willing to give the government the benefit of the doubt on this occasion, given the circumstances that we're in. But that's not to say that we do so without those reservations still being in place, specifically around those of the elongation of some of the time scales involved, and also the very restrictive nature of the regulations that we're extending. Mm-hmm. So I guess the overarching point is we're happy to certainly, as a party, support them, but do so reluctantly, and also noting the method in which we've been asked to do it reluctantly.
Okay, thanks very much. Colette, I'll bring you in.
With an observation based on the papers that were submitted, and it was in relation to obviously the restrictions that have been put in place. Now, I know that Theresa Medhurst has introduced, and it's within the annex of the actual establishments, and you know, in terms of how they've used those restrictions in each of the different establishments. But the one thing that I want to point out is that this is between October 2021 and February 22. I'm fully aware and I'm conscious of the fact that these restrictions have obviously been in place a lot longer than that, and obviously to varying degrees within each establishment. And again, I just want to put on record my concern there for the mental health of some of the prisoners, given that these restrictions have been in place for a lot longer. And I very much welcome the breakdown of each establishment and what restrictions have been put in place, but it has actually been going on for a lot longer. That's really all I wanted to comment on that. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. Just while we're online, I'd invite Rona or Fulton, if you would like to make any comments, if you can maybe indicate that. If not, I'll just... Katie, have you got anything you want
yes,
to...
Yes, and I associate with the myself with the procedural points which have been made. In terms of the substantive issues, we took evidence from the Cabinet Secretary regarding political oversight, and I think it is important that we put on record that we do expect a high level of political oversight, both by ministers, but also... by the Scottish Prison Service itself, because obviously this is giving and has given governors significant powers, and it's important that they are used with consistency, that they're proportionate and they're necessary. So I do think it would be helpful if this committee could put on record the importance of political oversight, and particularly the role of politicians, not to make decisions as such, but to ensure that that the decisions that are making are consistent and proportionate. And I would also include this committee in that, and to pick up on the points that Colette is making that I do think this committee should be kept regularly advised of the decisions that are taken so that we're able to give that political oversight also.
Okay, thank you very much indeed for that. I appreciate members' comments on that, and I too would certainly put on record on behalf of the committee that whilst we're agreeing with the SSI, we do not want to see these powers remain in place indefinitely, and that we would certainly expect to be kept updated on how they are being used and implemented. Okay, thank you very much for that. So that concludes the public part of the meeting. We will now move into private session to review the evidence we've heard this morning, and we'll take a short 5-minute suspension before we move into private session. Thank you.